GRIS is an atmospheric puzzle platformer by Spanish indie studio Nomada Studio. When it came out in late 2018, it was acclaimed for its gorgeous watercolors by Conrad Roset and its exceptional soundtrack by Spanish band Berlinist, who also made the soundtrack to puzzle game Moncage recently. However, people have been less unanimous about the gameplay, and to me it is quite unfair. Actually, GRIS is meant to be metaphorical in both substance and form, in what you can see and hear and how you play it. GRIS is the eponymous character of the game. She's a young girl whom we meet right at the beginning, in the game's introduction, which instantly sets the tone for the quality of this work and what it evokes. The world that the game shows us, although very limited at the beginning since the whole introduction takes place in the hand of a statue, is immediately defined as unreal and metaphorical. First of all, the place. We don't see anything except a hand, probably a woman's hand, and GRIS sound asleep in the palm of said hand. We can hear the wind blowing, and the colors in the background are blue, a very pale cyan, and white. We're in the sky, or rather out of any place. It even feels like we're outside of time. Then, if that hand is undoubtedly that of an inanimate object, here a statue, given the cracks and the vague color, it is clearly moving. There's another clue, but this one's in the music. We can hear a melodic line being sung, and then there are two voices. And we can see GRIS singing. The voice would be diegetic, it would be an actual part of the scene, but the second voice, whose would that be? There is no one else here but the statue. The physics too are quite unrealistic as we watch GRIS float above the hand while singing in a truly beautiful shot that perfectly illustrates the girl's serenity in her art, her dress and hair fluttering in the wind. But this serenity is suddenly crushed. After a phrase sung in a duet, GRIS sings one last note, alone, and then puts her hands on her throat before collapsing in the palm of the statue's hand, which starts bursting into pieces before our eyes. Therein lies one of the strengths of this game. There is absolutely no narration necessary to make us understand what's happening to GRIS, only a few gestures are enough. As soon as we see the first shot, it is made very clear that the statue is GRIS's mother. The strength of their relationship is shown by the fact that GRIS is able to sleep in the statue's hand, as well as the duet they seem to be singing together. The statue's hand is damaged since the very beginning as a way to illustrate how fragile life is. This hand becomes fissured while GRIS is still singing. As long as we hear the two voices, the hand keeps on moving, but as soon as the cracks start appearing, it stops moving. All this leads to this last note that GRIS sings alone. Her mother is no longer here, and it's the moment when GRIS loses her voice, just as her life loses its meaning. The music gives us as much information. The opening is very soft, as is the first shot with GRIS asleep in her mother's hand. The game opens with an F minor piano chord with the voice soon catching up. It's a relatively fast 4/4, which nonetheless sounds very calm due to the piano's rhythm. One chord on the bar's first three beats and two eighth notes on the last beat. Consequently, it is relatively hard to feel the pulse, hence the aforementioned idea that we are out of time. The vocal line starts with a descending half tone, A flat G, and progressively opens up in the higher register. The ambitus soon reaches more than one octave, thus highlighting how much GRIS trusts her mother, while the piano part starts getting slightly more complex with light syncopations that gives an impression that time sometimes is suspended due to the shift between on beats and off beats. Eventually, she's joined by the second voice in homorhythm. This one is only doubling Gris's voice as a support, mostly with sixth and thirds, while the piano keeps on progressing with now parallel octaves. As Gris sings her last note, a high F, after the statue has started becoming cracked and we can already hear some loud noises, the piano logically transitions into arpeggios in 16th notes. The rhythm gets faster, the tension is increasing. Those arpeggios are rather static at first, before being used on a larger ambitus, now an octave. The chords are incomplete. Some pads are added, nothing more is happening in the melody, Gris has now lost her voice. Yet this part is much more than a transition. Gris is trying to reach a safe place near the palm of the statue's hand, as the latter is exploding under her feet. The explosion sounds have our full attention at that moment, as well as Gris's escape, so it's very pertinent to have kept but the harmony. The animation of that part is actually breathtaking. Look at those few seconds at half the speed and you'll see a large set of emotions on Gris's face. She shuts an eye to protect herself from the stones and right before she falls, facing the inevitable, you can see her mouth wide open, her face giving away her fear. The strings gradually get louder during Gris's fall and now that she can't do anything any longer, another melody now stands out. It's the same half tone that started the first melody, A flat G. Now we only hear those two notes in the high register this time, the tone being very similar to that of a voice, with a portamento and a blending effect each time, giving the impression that Gris is crying for help and that her cry is getting lost in the sky, although she's singing no longer. This call ends only to come back one last time, a last call that's never to be heard. The first call ends on the A flat, A flat, G, A flat. The second almost ends on the G, you can barely hear the last note. Gris is giving up. At the same time, the instrumentation is getting heavier. The piano is mixing arpeggios and chords, the strings are higher, we can hear the brass instruments appear, as well as an audible bass. After the last call, the organ is added in stepwise motions, wonderfully illustrating Gris's fall, that fade out when the brass instruments take over in a very spectacular way as the young girl appears smaller and smaller before vanishing. After that climax, followed by a short fermata, the piano plays again a few chords very softly and slightly arpeggiated. We still are in F minor. Now that the astonishment is over, Gris's journey can now begin. So, it only takes us a few seconds to understand that the universe of Gris is a metaphor for its titular character's state of mind. The statue's hand blowing is Gris's world falling to pieces, and this never-ending fall obviously isn't real. It's the beginning of Gris's grief after her mother's death. It's no secret that Gris deals with grief and, more generally, depression. From this point forward, Gris is in a world like her, grey. Gris means grey in Spanish and French. Deprived of four colors she will have to restore, red, green, blue, and yellow. That's not all. There's also a large constellation which seems to have disappeared in the sky, and many stars will be necessary to recreate it and allow Gris to leave this altered world. So Gris is going to walk for a long time, because these things do take time, gain a few powers that will allow her to move forward and interact with the world. Those interactions have been carefully chosen and are related to the different steps she has to take. On her way, she will collect small lights that will create other paths, thus helping her move forward. Those very lights will then fill the main constellation. Other puzzles will grant her collectibles called mementos. Contrary to the stars, you don't need those to finish the game. However, if you collect all of them, you unlock a little cutscene at the end of the game, a memory of Gris that explains the origin of the main metaphor of the game, the constellation. But most importantly, Gris will learn how to sing again. The game has five areas, each corresponding to one of the five stages of grief: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. To reach these zones, except for the first one in which you just land and can be considered a tutorial, you have to go through a castle which acts as a hub. Once you come back to that castle, the environment has changed and a new zone is accessible, yet you can't backtrack. Once again, it's metaphorical. Each zone being associated to one of the stages of grief, it's reassuring not to be able to go back. Also, there's no way to manually save the game's progress. It autosaves after you reach a milestone, for instance when you collect a star or a memento, or after achieving an important part of the game. It may appear frustrating, but again it's quite a judicious choice. Unfortunately, there's no way to choose how you progress in such an emotional quest. You may fear returning to the beginning, yet the game gives us hope. Some events are strong enough to prevent us from going back. At first, it's denial. It's only after this world that the title of the game appears, as if it could no longer be, well, denied. The game doesn't start immediately, at least not at the pace you would think. After standing up, Gris walks slowly, her eyes, although hidden by her hair, fixed on the ground. Eyes fixed on my thoughts, Victor Hugo would say. The usual controls don't work. If you try to jump, you fall. If you try another button, which you will later use to sing, Gris emits a faint cry that is immediately muffled. It seems that she can't do anything, she has to learn everything again. It seems like Gris's world has to be completely rebuilt, or rather revealed. The music comes down to soft ambient noises. You can hear the wind blowing and the footsteps of the eponymous character. On the screen, a mere black hand-drawn line stands for the ground, but the background, completely white, gradually becomes transparent and allows us to see dunes and birds, white as well. Gris is then partially hidden by a smoke screen, an effect that will be used throughout the game. While at the very beginning, Gris takes up almost the whole screen, which could be a way to show that her sadness obscures everything else, as the white background becomes transparent, the game zooms out, allowing us to see both the heroine and her environment. It is at this point that Gris changes for the first time. She stands up, looks up to the sky, brings her hand to her face and shakes her head. This acts as an awakening. The music starts and Gris rushes forward. The animation of her movement, although relatively slow, gives a very dynamic and determined impression. Gris is now drawn with little stink limbs, the main part of her sprite being her dress, the key element of her later additional movements. This makes her movement perfectly clear. She's running. To be honest, it almost looks like a Naruto run. There's a crucial point in Gris' music. The whole soundtrack is also a metaphor of Gris' coming back to life, of her finding her voice back. In the introduction, the young girl shared a vocal duet with her mother in a very melodic tune before losing this voice. Gris' voice is broken as well as the melody, and the point of the game's music will be to recreate this voice, this melody. That's why the music starts without a theme. The title is well chosen, Debris. And it's true that the setting for this time being is far from enchanting, although it is drawn with great delicacy. Rocks, more organic forms which look like trees, small pebbles that can actually walk, a desolate world but always a clearly metaphorical one. Once again, these are graphic elements that will be found throughout the game more and more developed. To illustrate this debris, Berlinist chose to work with a motif, repeated notes on the piano like an echo. Sometimes a single note, sometimes an interval. This illustrates both the fragmentation of the actual debris, the stones, and Gris' solitude. She's so alone that there is nothing to hear but the echo. It's also a way of expressing her inability to sing. Melody is impossible, as if she could only pronounce or repeat short syllables, like an echolalia. These repetitions sound very rhythmic, like Gris' running. However, they seem to convey a feeling of abandonment due to the fact that it always goes back to the same notes, the interval gets shorter and the motion is often descending. Yet they are supported by relatively light pads that give momentum thanks to the quite sudden crescendo. As the landscape becomes fuller and the first elements of the gameplay appear, the pulse stabilizes and a first more melodic motif can finally be heard on the piano in the lower register. It's like a melody that would still hide, as the intervals are sometimes very wide and the rhythm relatively slow, almost erratic. We discover the main mechanics of the game, the one that allows us to move forward by collecting lights to form small paths, like constellations. Each time it appears in the game, this path constellation means that we're moving forward. To connect, to join, means to progress. A first breathtakingly relevant metaphor of depression. A second, even more melodic element, this time in the higher register, can be heard at the end of the title, which concludes with the dominant note, where in D minor and the last note is an A, as if time were slightly suspended. In the game, the track then starts over completely, and by using the dominant it softens the conclusion, thus making the loop sound more organic. It would be difficult to loop a music if it ended like a Beethoven symphony. Another mechanic is introduced, the mementos. They are linked to Gris' past, and from this area, their location in the game is judiciously chosen, as we often have to retrace our steps to obtain them. Collectibles are often hidden, you might say, it is true, but here the metaphor, again, is particularly striking. Recovering mementos often requires an effort, a small platforming section, for example, or exploration, and it makes us go back. We're stuck in the past. A final thought about the constellations. They mean at the same time progress, moving forward, but also, in my opinion, they evoke the past, especially childhood, given how they worked on the sound effects. When you walk on a constellation path, you trigger little sounds very similar to those of a music box, something commonly associated with childhood. These sounds systematically stand out from the rest of the game's soundscape because they do not follow the harmony of the music, unlike the sounds when you chime in Journey, for instance. but here they rather remain in F minor, the key that opens and closes the game. During the game we are a bit in between D minor, D major, E minor, but never F minor, except when a new color is added to the world, which is one step towards the end. After all this, a hand emerges from this debris, the hand of the statue. Gris's dress then takes the shape of a brush, and while Gris is crying, a new color appears, a new step is taken. Comes the time of anger in a red desert. But before entering this area, there's one thing left to discover, the castle or the hub. Located just below the large constellation that is to be filled in, it is found after each zone, and there you discover the path to the new zone. To reach the desert, nothing could be simpler. You let yourself slide on an endless slope of red sand, or rather red pigment, in an obvious tribute to Journey. The music finally becomes more concrete with low strings. In Journey, the solo instruments are the flute, often the bass flute, and the cello. The repetitions become a little more chaotic without a complete abandon. They are simply here to translate this exhilarating character of this acceleration. Everything has an end. One more tower to climb, and the title of the game finally appears as a way to end denial, a heartbreaking acknowledgement. The music is just as conclusive. Desert and anger await us. To overcome anger, we need to get through three zones. The first one is a desert full of spears and stone constructions, a vast desert in which Gris still appears very small. The game really shows us an infinite world, infinite but filled with emptiness, with hollowness. The color palette mostly uses an intense, deep red, a blood red, but as in the whole game, it remains very nuanced. Numerous wind turbines announce very violent gusts of wind and sand, represented by a smoke effect, gusts that Gris can only escape at first by hiding, therefore waiting, in the sometimes moving, even anthropomorphic stone structures. Like in the first area, we find debris surrounding most of the stone structures, which also contain the first power that Gris is going to obtain. She is hungry, she is going to learn how to turn her dress into a cube, mainly in order to break what's around her. The music is more melodic than in the first part of the game, but also more dramatic. In the same key as Debris, D minor, it alternates between the piano and two more dramatic, even spectacular elements, the organ and the choir, which appear and disappear with a fade-in, fade-out effect like the sandstorms. There is very little progress in the music. The piano part, although more melodic than before, is based on the arpeggios of the different chords of the harmony, which remains very simple, whereas the organ is systematically on the tonic. A low D on the left hand and fast stepwise motions or thirds on the right hand, like outbursts of anger sustained by the choir. This obsession with the tonic reminds us of the wind that inevitably pushes Gris back. Nothing seems to be evolving. The whole sequence is very fragmented because of the gameplay alternating phases during which you progress and phases during which you wait, and even though the music is more melodic than before, it's also fragmented thanks to the alternation between the piano and the organ. It's no longer the debris of the previous zone, but the cohesion is not there yet. As Gris obtains her first power, she can use it in two ways, to destroy and to protect herself. Indeed, she's not blown away when cube-shaped, she can even walk during the storms. As she uses her power this way before reaching the second zone of anger, the organ's harmony slightly changes to announce an evolution in the game which until then seems stuck in this alternation as stylized outbursts of anger, before returning to the tonic chord D minor, still in a very spectacular way with a choir and an almost painful bass. Our newly acquired power takes us into the very short transition zone with no music, except for a few diegetic bell sounds. It also takes us out of it, launching us again, without warning, in the last zone depicting anger, the windmill. And in this mill, like the game that makes us go up and down constantly, the music is just ascending and descending motions like hopes gently crushed. The first arpeggio announces the key, always D minor. This will soon change, but it's interesting to have kept this key for a large part of the beginning of the game, insofar as we don't seem able to move forward. It's as if we're stuck in this harmonic framework, as we are stuck in our mind. However, Berlinist avoids any musical redundancy since this key is always used in a different way. The sensations evolve, and even if the overall feeling seems to be the same, sadness, there have been many nuances since the beginning. It's the same for the colors. Although each area is based on one color, there are many hues and we can't really talk about monochromy or monotony. We start with the short crescendo from Debris, then the piano comes in, very softly in small patterns repeated at first, then in longer sequences, though always based on repetition. It's more melodic than in the desert, all the music of the game being built on this evolution from non-melody to the return of the melody of the voice, even if we can hear some echo effects again with the quickly repeated notes. The choice of the high register at this point is very relevant because it's a transition like a commentary, a last thought before a stronger statement, a very beautiful passage with heavy chords which sometimes reveals a beat, in fact a regular rhythm superimposed on quickly minor arpeggios, some energy before a second passage in the high register. Keyboard becomes softer, but this should not deceive us. A few moments later, a disturbing sound appears, similar to a voice. Many elements come back together, the sudden crescendos, the repeated notes, the beat, here superimposed on more chaotic notes, but still guided by the D minor arpeggio, culminating only to disperse immediately, like a memory that will almost come true before fading away. The loop closes with a return of the initial crescendos. It sounds like notes played backwards, there are many in the soundtrack to make up for the fact that time can be reversed. This is one of my favorite parts from the soundtrack because without even a single word it tells with more accuracy than any speech what Gris is feeling. How hard it is to say things through the repetition of the first piano motifs and the fact that they are sometimes lost. Hopes, as in bargaining, the next area, suddenly crushed, but also strength, undeniable in some moments when you can hear the soft fullness of the music and her freedom despite her sadness. But I am talking about something more than simply descriptive music, music that would be a speech, but a speech without words. The idea of repetition evolved. From the echolalia in Debris, there was then an aestheticized reverb and speed in the sound surfing segment, to finally include the repetition in a speech, certainly still difficult but more developed in the windmill. There are also gentle diegetic sounds, the same as in the first two zones of anger, bells tinkling and footsteps of small anthropomorphic pebbles. We also hear the sounds of clock mechanisms, similar to a solar system like in the title screen, and the mill. It's still not much in this vast world. There is a positive element in this zone. Our only power is now used to restart mechanisms, to release a balloon. Therefore, this part of the adventure can be seen as a reflection on time. While everything is static, we turn things back on, we get the clocks going again, just as the music regularly starts again. However, we restart perpetual motion machines like a metaphor of a wish for eternity. Anger is still there. That's why the pulse is still blurred in the music. It's also here that the first elements involving trust appear, which represents a transition to the next color, where we will no longer be alone. Some gaps are filled in just as we think we are falling to make us move forward or to allow us to find a memento. Trust is built, the small risks we're taking are rewarded. It is true that the gameplay is reassuring insofar as there is no way to die in this huge world where you can't get lost or even fall too far down. But what is this world? One last mechanism to trigger, that of a huge wheel, and again we become a brush to release a new color, green. We now slide on a vine and dive into a new area, the forest. It's time for the next step, bargaining. It's the first time we actually meet someone, admittedly a stone cube, but apparently endowed with more consciousness than the small animated objects we run into until now. We also find at the beginning of this zone a presence already met before, a swarm of black butterflies, the same ones that had launched us in the windmill area, which here destroyed the bridge connecting the hub to this forest. Their presence is worrying because it's preventing us from being totally in control, from making our own choices. It's true that we've never been able to go back to a previous area before, however, here this is violent enough to warn us. Another element may be a little disturbing. The trees are straight and very tall, emphasizing the vertical dimension, so they can remind us that we are at the bottom. We are still sinking, but in a comfortable world, the noise of the trees is quite soothing, their animation soft and almost liquid. It's nevertheless in this zone that the music finally finds a melody, and most of all a soothed voice, though purely instrumental. The title is appropriate, komorebi, a Japanese word that evokes the sunlight filtering through the leaves of a tree. The sound design was until now rather hard, connected with a brittle reality, whether with a definite pitch, the bells, or without for the most part, of the destructible elements, the small anthropomorphic stones, except for the long descent on the sand, more dreamlike. It is now more soft and round, the small black balls, the suzuwatari, that appear and disappear, the birds, there are now many, and later the new ability, the double jump, will highlight the sound of the dress fabric softer. Everything is less silent. In the music too, the tones are immediately softer than in the desert, although the windmill area was indeed a beautiful transition. There is no dramatic organ nor crier, nothing spectacular. The key is now D major, whereas until now we had remained in minor keys, F minor in the introduction and then D minor for a long time. It's a slight tonal evolution. It would seem that the game is trying to convey peacefulness, fulfillment, although probably relative. The large intervals at the very beginning of the piece, the major 7th, D, C sharp, and the major 9th, D, E, may illustrate this uncertainty, but also a beginning of wonder, as do the cello notes, which are somewhat scattered, almost random. The phrasing closes after each note, the melody is difficult to really feel, because the phrasing makes each note almost independent of the others. It is only after several minutes that a real melody can finally be heard on the cello, with the large intervals of the very beginning as a small contrapuntal element. This is not the last time we're going to hear this, a small motif that appears insignificant and most of all without real structure, not really locked in the rhythmic framework, which is actually perfectly so, therefore contributing to the music's richness. Better still, this idea is pushed further when the melody is played a second time on the cello, but in the background. This time, what was only the accompaniment is put forward in a higher register, forming internal real melody. The elements that sounded like questions are now quite different, and it's mostly peacefulness, almost hope, that we feel as Gris bonds with the small cube. The latter acts as a mirror. Like us, he's sad, we can see him crying, and most likely shy, since he hides when Gris turns to him. He mimics our running, his arms backwards, Naruto run for everyone, and when we jump or turn into a block, he does the same. That's why there are repetitions in the music, at least in the soundtrack version, not in game. Each time we reach a new level of trust with him, the music evolves. We tame him by offering him cubic apples in quantities far too large for such a small cube, which could be an illustration of bargaining, but the bonds we form with this little guy are stronger than that. I like to think that the bargaining resides in the new power gain, the double jump. It's a rather passive double jump, we float more than we actually jump, which is often used in combination with small red birds. With their help, we are propelled upwards. We free them by breaking vases, we destroy a part of the world, but there is the reward of being able to progress. And this world is not meaningless. To me, it's probably the world Gris imagined with her mother. She finds herself isolated in a world she can no longer share, because it was with her mother that she could do it, just as it was with her that she shared singing. When we get this double jump, our little cubic friend has joined his fellow creatures. Gris is alone again. The balance is decidedly always fragile. The music changes. It's still a bit uncertain tonally, because it's not very tonally focused, I would say. Now it's time to explore a structure similar to the hub, the castle, in which, as in the forest, we find these trees with apparent roots, as in a mangrove. They can look similar to family trees by their cubic shape and their strong symmetry. The organ becomes much more intimate, creating a beautiful background with the sustained chords, which is difficult to do on the piano. Even using the pedal, the sound is muted at some point, whereas on the organ the sound is sustained. It's also a very versatile instrument whose sound can vary from one extreme to the other, both regarding tone and power, which matches what Gris is going through. It can be as spectacular as in the introduction, as it can accompany her scent, thanks to the birds, with infinite gentleness. We find the same tones as in the previous piece, but it sounds like they're holding back, as if the long exploration, although pleasant, was slightly tinged with more uncertainty than before. From a tonal point of view, the piece is less focused and does not have a moment of plenitude like the previous one, in which all the instruments come together. However, in the soundtrack, this part ends with a very beautiful flute solo, as if Gris was completely freed from her sorrow, while she only has to jump higher and higher with the help of the red butterflies. But higher is also lonelier. This is when the black butterflies reappear, coming together to form a Japanese raven, Karazu, superbly animated, which seems to be made of a substance thicker than ink, but still as fluid. Music mainly uses the lost strings martellato, which can remind us of the twitchy animation of the bird when it gazes almost inquisitively at Gris, and its heavy footstep which makes the whole screen shake. The choir returns, as well as the piano and the high strings, more lyrical, but it is most of all the bird's screams pushing us away that we hear like the desert's gusts of wind, with the difference that here we must escape from a visible enemy. Visually, the red reappears gradually as the sequence unfolds, to end only in red and black at the very end, as the bird dislocates to the sound of the bells and the butterflies disappear. We can finally finish this castle's ascent and find the statue. This time the world is covered with blue, a very obvious choice since we are now entering the next area, depression. It is an underground area located under the castle. The color palette is centered around blue, which doesn't take up the whole screen. We walk through underground alcoves, half filled with water, whose volumes are delimited by large black flat tints, and sometimes brightened by small touches of very vibrant colors. Again, the sound design evolves. It is always soft, with a touch of magic from now on, the small red butterflies under the black domes, or like when we slide and there's ice and snow under our feet, with a discreet reverb to remind us that we are still alone. The music begins in a rather interrogative way. The title speaks for itself, Descent. Although we're in E minor, the music's rather centered around the dominant B, thus sounding suspended. The tones and the reverberation illustrate the acoustics of this underground cave. Translucent layers of sound are lifted by dynamic piano motifs, but there is no more substantial element yet. The game at this point only lays the foundations for this area's gameplay. The melody carefully takes shape, but it seems a bit diluted, as much by the other tones very present as by the rhythm, especially the pulse almost absent. Only the piano motifs of the introduction, more dynamic and rhythmically structured, come to punctuate this descent. They allow to keep track of the pulse, not to abandon oneself completely. We go deeper and deeper into a small cave where an ice ray regularly makes a copy of ourselves. From now on, our dress will take the shape of a small manta ray so that we can propel ourselves underwater, allowing us to head towards the depths. It is thus double-edged. At the beginning, we have no control. As a cube, we sink and it's difficult to go back to the surface, but we go up anyway. Swimming gives us control, but this control means we can swim deeper. And this is what seems to be happening. We dive, again and again. The bass is then more present, reflecting the danger of our never-ending descent. Simultaneously, a melody similar to the previous one and treated in the same rhythmic way can be heard on the piano. It develops for quite a long time, the piece itself being very long, 10 minutes, while on the screen the colors diversify. The strings come in, then another solo element. In both cases, we find this attempt at a melody, which never seems to be completely finished, like a voice that can't really sing. But halfway through, the piece seems to start again. We hear the piano motifs, then the strings, with the more melodic piano part than the bass. All the elements previously introduced now blend together in a very beautiful counterpoint, very rich and most of all very organic, like the puzzles of the game which require us to use all our abilities, sometimes in a quick succession, and the colors varied and blent, though dominated by blue. The next stars we collect unlock a turtle. Following it, we now reach the depth of this huge underground cavity, and it seems that we are giving ourselves into depression, seeing as everything is now painted in shades of blue. At the top of this beautiful contrapuntal moment, the piano now plays octaves just as we find the statue of Gris's mother. Indeed, since the beginning of the game, with each color unlocked, we witness the same thing. We find a part of the statue, the little stars collected during the level come to line up, following the curve of the statue's hand, and Gris, whose dress turns into a brush, cries, painting the world with new shades. Each time the animation changes. The first two times, color drops appear like tears of paint splashing on a sheet, and the different shades are quickly superimposed. After fighting the bird, we dive into depression in a slower animation, like the paint that diffuses when we dip a brush in a glass of water. In the last one, stars just burst out of her, like tears that nothing seems to be able to stop, and the world around her begins to rebuild itself. Each time, the statue is more complete. At first, only the fingers emerge from the sand, the second time the hands in a welcoming gesture, then we also see the head half broken. This time the statue is almost whole, except for the belly, and almost comes to life again when the statue's eyes open. Each time the music is more complex, although the theme remains the same, it's very close to the theme of the introduction that Gris sung in a duet with her mother, and in the last scene we finally hear Gris's voice. It's precisely when Gris gets a new power. She seems to find her voice again, but only emits a faint cry just before the statue collapses, and Gris is once again confronted with those butterflies that turn into ink monsters. Now is the time to escape from Unagi, the Japanese eel. This scene is an escape sequence in two similar parts during which we are chased by a huge, monstrous eel which can split in two or spit out hundreds of smaller eels. Delightful. Another jewel of animation when you look at the solid and massive animal and the symmetry of the eel's movements when they're two. For such a decisive moment, a beautiful percussion roll appears crescendo, it's more of a sound fading. There's a choir again, as well as the strings, which are not martellato as in Karazu, but the bow stroke is still resolute, especially the small ostinato motif on the cellos. Very much like the second ostinato in stepwise motions that can be heard on the strings, which for me evokes the eel itself, its fluid and disturbing movements, its relentless attacks, its heavy presence, while the choir seems to give away Gris's and the player's fear by its exclamations. These sequences are separated by a central part where the navigation is more classic, but which admirably blurs the lines. In the dark, yellow jellyfish light up one after another, while making a rather muffled noise that gives the impression that the eel is hidden nearby. The music beautifully maintains the tension. The pulsation seems to disappear, the solo instrument is in descending motions over two octaves, notes that seem a little scattered, indecisive, but which come back, supported by drum rolls. However, this whole central part is supported by the tireless repetition of the tonic E in a shimmering sound effect, at first barely audible, as the tones blend together, then more and more captivating while the cello disappears. The cello returns, taking over in this exhilarating repetition, far from the initial debris. The repetition now acts as a support, joined by the strings and then the bass, then the choir. The strings now play in octaves, then they accompany the rising power of the eel, which is always faster and whose attacks are more frequent. Until freedom, when GRIS is saved by the turtle in charge of dispersing this second monster, the piano punctuating with glorious octaves this ending where the brass instruments, with a very nice phrasing, really shine. But GRIS is a game in which you don't die, where you can't get lost for very long. The chase can therefore happen without any intervention on our part, except in the middle part with the jellyfish. And yet I can't help smashing the controller's button as I'm so afraid that GRIS will get eaten by the eel. And at the end, although I perfectly know what's going to happen, until the very last moment I'm afraid to abandon her, just like in Journey when the storm rages and we keep chirping even though we know we're going to collapse in the snow at any moment. It's on this field that GRIS plays. The game forces us to be compassionate and help the girl all the way through by blurring the lines between what we can and cannot do, the control we have over the situation or not. During the game, we often lose control, we slide, we fall, sometimes it feels like it will never end, or the wind that blows us away. To compensate, the game gives back some control, sometimes in a redundant way. It's actually useless to be able to propel GRIS because the escape is automatic. Control is indeed minimal, but it does exist, and it also reminds us of the control GRIS can have over her own condition. Even if she thinks she doesn't have any, in fact she does, even though the final escape is possible thanks to the turtle. And now it's time for the longest part of the game, acceptance. After being saved by a turtle, which took care of dispersing the eel that was chasing us, GRIS can now swim back up to the surface. Thanks to the ability acquired in this zone, the underwater propulsion, now used in a positive way to go up, this ascent is faster than the long descent into the depths. However, it is not passive. We're not propelled towards the next zone at the end of the chase. We actually have to do it. It's important to push ourselves to go back up to the hub, thanks to the same ability that previously allowed us to dive again and again, deeper and deeper. However, this phase still shows a lot of fragility. It is partly done in the dark, with light appearing suddenly, intermittently. The colors are not all present yet, only blue and sometimes yellow, still surrounded by large black areas. The symmetry of the game is heard in the music, since the title Descent finds its matching opposite Ascension, which reflects this uncertainty. The mood is still dark, almost solemn. The first minute consists solely of arpeggios carefully revealed, with sounds that manage to convey the volume of this world, its depth, the distance we still have to travel to reach the surface. Small ascending motions on the strings come to plaintively light up this ascension, while two somewhat disturbing elements seem to bring us back to the depths, in addition to those descending motions which contrast with the fact that we're supposed to swim up to the surface. First, there are chords in the very low register on the organ. I would say the instrument is often heard in the soundtrack and can produce the lowest notes. And repeated notes on the bass, sometimes lost in the other tones, but so low that we feel the vibrations more than we hear the notes. We reach the castle, however, and make our way to the next area, the last one, where the gameplay will play directly on one of the metaphors of Gris's morning. Since her world is upside down, we will experience changes in gravity, albeit very modestly, since there will be no inverted controls. If we want to go left on the screen, we press left regardless of the gravity, nothing like the forlorn runes in Ori and the Blind Forest. It is true that the imagery of the game relies a lot on verbal metaphors. Gris's world is collapsing, it is upside down. As for her mother, she is associated with the stars. There is a sun in the background almost all the time. We also see the moon, finally a constellation. She's also pictured in a spectacular way by the statues, always huge. She took up the whole space in her daughter's heart. All these metaphors, although very simple, are sublimated by the graphic interpretation. Here we are far above the castle and, as in the game's introduction, as if we were outside the world. But what is this world? The question has been asked before and the answers are obviously multiple. I had evoked the idea that it was linked to the young girl and her mother, that this was in fact the world that they had both been able to create. In the game's bonuses, we can find a slightly simplified map of this world we are led to explore with Gris. It's a realistic world given its landscapes, a desert, a forest, an underground cave, up to the last zone beyond the large constellation we have to recreate. The background evokes the most beautiful nebulae. It's already a little less realistic in the sense that we can't normally get that close to them and the physics is disturbed, although we've seen this kind of effect before, the floating water tables in the vast underground cavity. But the introduction had brilliantly revealed the metaphorical character of the game, of its world, from the first shot. This last zone also underlines Gris's solitude throughout her journey. She seems all the more isolated here, as she's physically far from the ground, but she has almost always been alone without being alone. Small anthropomorphic stones regularly followed her. The underground world was not devoid of fish, including a pretty Mona Mola, but only in the forest did she establish ties with the cube and his fellow creatures, and it's also there that the music became more peaceful, more melodic as well. There's, however, a great feeling of loneliness that almost overwhelms us during the game. Loneliness amplified by Gris's footsteps, which very rarely find other steps to share a few moments together, and are often only reverberated in this world of prodigious dimensions, sometimes without any music at all. It is also a complete world with several biomes and in which her mother is omnipresent. There are several statues of her, some of which we necessarily encounter, the largest, and some we find only if we search well enough. It's finally time for Gris's last ability, which is no longer related to the shape of a dress, although it changes when it's used. It is indeed a power that comes from Gris herself. She sings again. And what's very beautiful is that from now on she finds a way to reveal the world without destroying it. Through her singing, she allows flowers to bloom, mechanisms to restart. It is also a way to release the last colors, because if the main structure is blue, Gris's singing reveals red, pink, green. She has to sing in order for all the colors to be there. We walk under the firmament and the music has finally found a soothing melody with ethereal sounds, accompanied in the game by a delicate sound design almost otherworldly now. The half spider, it has only four legs, the hummingbirds, the splashes when Gris dives and comes out of the water, the puzzles are for large part aquatic, the small cue when you change gravity. The music is also often discreet enough, ambient enough, so as not to hide the girl singing. The true melody is sung by Gris herself when she gets the final ability. And the instrumentation has this dreamlike character too, like the sound design, whereas earlier in the forest and underwater, the solo instruments gave the music a more tangible feeling. We also find temporal elements in this part. I had previously mentioned the fact that in the mill, the last area of anger, Gris was restarting perpetual motions which could indicate a reflection on time, a wish for eternity, yet crushed by the death of Gris's mother. The mill itself was a sign of it by its infinite rotation. Here some puzzles are based on the passing of time and its transforming space. Some platforms appear for a moment and then slowly fade away. This is a clever way of associating and adapting classic platforming mechanics to the game's metaphor, but with the safety of being able to start again. From the moment Gris's world starts rebuilding itself, when she unlocks yellow before being chased by the eel, the game plays on symmetry and asymmetry. The world, essentially the large structures like the castle where we return after each area to complete the constellation, is completed symmetrically, but there's an asymmetry between the runes, made of stone, relatively damaged, and what is rebuilt, which appears transparent and intact. Thus, what was damaged remains that way. As she's reaching the acceptance phase, I like to think that it's a way of evoking that accepting the death of her mother doesn't mean forgetting her. What was there remains there, without idealization. Symmetry is a common thread of the game, since some of the exploration can be done in a completely symmetrical way, and puzzles are often placed symmetrically on both sides of central hub, when there's the turtle for instance, or under the firmament. This slightly helps developing the exploration, whereas at the beginning the progression was linear. Finally, Gris can put the world back into place. The constellation is full, but there is one last test left. The ink monster takes a third form, that of Gris herself. At that moment in the game, we are back to reality, since I think it now shows the most difficult moment for Gris, the burial. We see Gris's mother's grave, and I doubt it's metaphorical here, I see it very literally on the contrary. But she manages to sing. The music is based on the same elements as in the introduction, hence the titles Gris Part 1 and Gris Part 2. The keys the same, F minor, the instrumentation, piano, voice, strings, brass, organ and percussion. The thematic elements are the same too, with the difference, however, that it sounds in medias res. Immediately the pulse is there, whereas in the introduction it took a little time to really be audible. We start immediately with a very defined melody in an already high, more plaintive register. The piano is more active, the thirds arrive very quickly, like the counterpoint of the cello alone and then on the strings. Everything moves forward like the sudden rise of this black ink that ends up swallowing up Gris as she sings one last note alone, mirroring the introduction where she began accompanied and ended alone. Here this last note announces the return of the second voice with a slightly darker tone. The statue sings again, powerfully sweeping away the ink that was consuming the young girl. As soon as the statue starts singing, her fingers move again symmetrically with the introduction, where the fingers froze as the first track appeared. The duet can resume, and it's interesting to hear that during this short moment, the two voices are more independent than at the beginning, when the second voice, the mother's, was only doubling her daughter's in homorhythm, a way of illustrating her protective character. Here it's slightly different. Gris manages to overcome the pain as the two melodic lines individualize until the climax, when she takes up the melodic line that opened the game an octave higher, and while in the introduction, the climax with the organ, the brass and bass accompanied Gris's tragic fall, which seemed to never end as the young girl appeared smaller and smaller. Here the same musical elements underline her return to life and her regained smile in a very beautiful shot. Another beautiful illustration, musical here, of the combination of symmetry and asymmetry. The worlds we had previously seen are recolored. While they sometimes already showed subtle nuances, their true colors are nevertheless revealed, as well as other reconstructed elements added, the water lilies, the towers in the underwater pod, for instance. She still saw her world through the spectrum of our emotions, but the nuances, like the emotions, were often mixed, although each time one color was highlighted. Now its true nature is revealed. There is only one last thing left after that, one last action to be made by the player after the statue brings Gris very close to the constellation. We help her take this long path now recreated, and as each step of the girl triggers the little sounds from a music box, like every time she walked on one of these constellations, the two voices unite before Gris disappears in a long fade to white. This moment is sometimes considered to be a little weak, but on the contrary, it's important to me not to end up on something too strong, and that there is a last action by the player after the previous, very powerful cutscene. We're still dealing with grief, and acceptance doesn't prevent sadness. It would make little sense to end on the cutscene, or to even include this last part in said cutscene. The metaphor remains extremely strong, especially for the player, who can accompany Gris all the way to the end. They are the one who allows the girl to take over, and for such a game, there's nothing more important. Gris is far from being the only game about depression, death, grief. Some are often dark, but not always. Rhyme, for instance, has a very vibrant color palette, and for some rather intended to make others understand what depression is, like Elude, without addressing those who suffer from it. Gris goes further than the apparent darkness of depression, for depression is not necessarily when our own world, this constellation made of what we love or what we believe in, is grey by nature, but seems so far away from others that the inability to share it can paint our world grey by its apparent uselessness. That's why the game's main mechanics, the paths created thanks to the stars we collect, was in my opinion a particularly striking and precise metaphor of what depression can be. Sometimes there's just no way to connect, to bond with others, and the game suggests that we can't do it again. It is also very beautiful, visually and orally elegant. I talked a lot about the music, but the sound design is full of very soft sounds, a ringing bell, a bird flying off, a little character coming out of the ground. The choice of a 2D game is also very relevant, and seeing the heroine almost constantly from the side puts the emphasis on her attitude and therefore her state of mind, eyes down but dynamic run, going forward despite her fear. It's a game without death, which for me was important at the time I discovered it and without any particular difficulty. But after finishing Celeste, just the any percent and a rather substantial number of strawberries, with more than 5,000 deaths, I put my relationship to death in video games into perspective. The puzzles are simple but varied in their design, and although they take up classic platforming elements, they are elegantly integrated into the characters' movements, it's very organic, and the game's metaphors. I had notably talked about trust, you fall and a platform appears, and time, which one wishes to be infinite, through perpetual motions, but knows to be counted. In the last bar, some platforms are only solid as long as they are illuminated. It's not that exploration-based either, because it's not really a matter of exploring the world, it's a matter of getting out of it. Thus, exploration remains limited because there's this thread, the constellation, this path to create in order to move forward. You can, however, take advantage of a few detours to collect mementos or discover a poignant secret. In that case, why make a game out of it? Why not keep only the animation? This is a criticism that comes up quite often. GRIS gameplay is modest, there is little to do, sometimes nothing at all except walk. But here walking is something that makes sense because it is intimately tied to the girl's impression, and the simple fact of moving forward is for her extremely meaningful. The game immediately showed us that it was entirely metaphorical, it never hid it, and the gameplay is involved in this metaphor. The bond between the player and the heroine, the empathy is born very quickly. Therefore, choosing to make GRIS a game means including ourselves in the story. For some, it means soothing our melancholy for a few moments by taking care of the heroine. But most of all, it means pushing us to actually do something, however modest it can be, to enjoy what this masterpiece has to offer. And it has a lot to offer. A story which, unfortunately, we are almost all confronted with, told without a single word, only through art.